welcome back. In this third and final part of our review of the just completed term, we'll consider first cases that continue the court's re-examination of separation of powers and federalism. We also have a brief video segment about this term's ERISA case. Then we'll look at five cases involving application of the habeas corpus statutes, and we'll close with cases involving copyright, punitive damages, and commercial arbitration. Let's turn now to segment one. This term may not have had as many blockbuster federalism and separation of powers cases as earlier terms, but the court was hardly silent on these matters. Here to discuss four cases are Irwin Chemerinsky of the University of Southern California School of Law and Ernest Young of the University of Texas Law School. Irwin, we included this first case, Whitman versus American Trucking. It's an EPA case because it looked for a while that perhaps this would be the Lopez of the delegation doctrine. It didn't turn out that way, 9-0. What did the court decide in this challenge to EPA rules?
The court held that the Clean Air Act is a permissible delegation of power to the Environmental Protection Agency. I think the significance of the cases shows that there's not going to be a revival of the non-delegation doctrine anytime soon. During the 1930s, in some famous cases, the Supreme Court struck down important federal laws as being excessive delegation of power to administrative agencies. Since 1937, not one federal law has been struck down on delegation doctrine grounds. The D.C. Circuit here, though, struck down portions of the Clean Air Act as an impermissible delegation of power. But the Supreme Court, in a unanimous opinion written by Justice Scalia, upheld this as permissible. The court was clear that statutes are allowed when they delegate power so long as they contain intelligible principles to guide the agencies in their exercise of discretion.
And the court found that here.
That's right.
Let's turn to federalism. Last you told us to watch for this case of Solid Waste Agency of Northern Cook County versus the Corps of Engineers. This involved a consortium of Chicago area municipalities that wanted to turn a abandoned sand and gravel pit into a solid waste disposal site. Corps of Engineers would not give them a permit to do that, citing the Clean Water Act and the Corps' own migratory bird rules. How does this case tie into the court's general jurisprudence on federalism and commerce?
The court said if it interpreted the Clean Water Act to apply to intrastate wetlands just because of the presence of migratory birds, there is serious constitutional doubts because the Congress had that authority in the Commerce Clause. So the court said it would interpret the statute narrowly to avoid the constitutional doubts. This is actually the second time in the last 2 years that the court has interpreted a statute narrowly to avoid possible problems regarding Congress's Commerce Clause authority. The other case was United States versus Jones in May of 2000, where the court interpreted the Federal Arson Act narrowly to not apply to arson or dwelling to avoid constitutional issues. I think what federal district courts are going to see is in many cases where lawyers in criminal and civil cases argue that federal statutes have to be interpreted narrowly to avoid possible constitutional issues regarding the scope of Congress's powers.
Thanks, Irwin. And that's just what we saw last part of the program earlier when we were talking about the immigration act as well.
That's right.
Let's turn now to the sovereign immunity case. This term, this involved a suit under the Americans with Disabilities Act. And do two things, and I know it's not easy to do it quickly, but first tell us what the essence of the court's sovereign immunity doctrine is now. And then why was Congress unable to abrogate the state's sovereign immunity under the ADA?
Well, you have to understand two cases to understand this one. One is Seminole Tribe versus Florida from 1996. Seminole held not only that the state's sovereign immunity is much broader than the text of the 11th Amendment explicitly provides for, but the Congress can't abrogate that immunity when it acts under its Article I powers. Seminole also made clear, though, that Congress can abrogate the state's immunity when it acts pursuant to its power to enforce the Reconstruction Amendments. We usually call that the Section 5 power. Now, City of Bernie versus Flores from 1997 sets out the parameters of Congress's Section 5 power. And what the court did in Garrett was to hold that the ADA is not valid Section 5 legislation.
What's Congress going to have to do in light of what they thought was quite a showing to abrogate the immunity under the Section 5 powers?
Well, the court focused on two aspects, really, of the statute. One was Congress's actual findings of discrimination, which the court found lacking. Now, that would suggest that Congress could get a different result under the same statute if it simply goes back and does its homework a little better. But I think the more important fact was the fact that the proportion of activity that was prohibited by the statute that was actually unconstitutional was not sufficiently large. The city of Bernie says that Congress can regulate some activity by the states that's not actually unconstitutional, but that proportion has to be relatively small. The problem in Garrett is that the ADA sweepingly bans all discrimination against the disabled, yet the disabled aren't a suspect class. Most discrimination against them is not unconstitutional. And the court's saying here that Congress, under those circumstances, can't enact the categorical ban.
I think it's important to emphasize here that the court did not declare Title I of the Americans with Disabilities Act unconstitutional as applied to state governments. In footnote 9 of the majority opinion, Chief Justice Rehnquist specifically says the law still can be applied to states through actions against individual officers or ex parte young or in suits by the federal government. Also, and I think it's notable, in footnote 1, Chief Justice Rehnquist said the court was not considering whether Title II of the Americans with Disabilities Act that deals with discrimination by the government providing services, whether that can be used to sue states directly. That's left for future litigation.
Thanks very much, Ernie. Ernie, we mentioned in the first part of the program the moral arm suit against the Massachusetts Attorney General. Erwin discussed the commercial speech aspects, but I said I was going to ask you, and I will now, tell us a bit about the preemption aspect in the federal cigarette regulations.
Well, the preemption holding was actually quite broad. The court held that all of the Massachusetts regulations were preempted as to cigarettes. The federal statute that did the preempting doesn't apply to smokeless tobacco or to cigars, and therefore the court had to go ahead and reach the First Amendment issues as to those issues. But everything that governed cigarettes was held to be preempted. And what strikes me about that holding is the lineup here. Justice Stevens says in dissent that there's a certain irony in the court's holding that the states are barred by federal law from regulating tobacco ads that are placed within 1,000 feet of a school. After all, the five justices in the majority here are the same five that gave us United States versus Lopez, which said that the federal government can't regulate to possession of guns within 1,000 feet of a school. Now, to be fair, the Commerce Clause and preemption issues are quite different in many ways. But it does highlight what's become a recurring pattern in the court, and that is that the supposedly more pro-states justices, people like Justice O'Connor here, Justice Scalia, actually tend to take a fairly broad view of federal preemption, while the supposedly more nationalist justices, like Justice Stevens or Justice Breyer, tend to be fairly protective of the state's regulatory prerogatives, at least in the preemption cases.
Thanks very much, and thank you to Erwin. Another context for federal statutory preemption, of course, is ERISA. ERISA preemption has been a staple in the court's docket for many years. We have a short segment on this year's ERISA case. Let's go to that now.
In recent years, the court seemed to shy away from finding preemption, but not in this term's case of Egelhoff v. Egelhoff. David Egelhoff's life insurance plan with Boeing made his wife Donna the beneficiary. There was no question the plan was governed by ERISA. Then the Egelhoffs divorced, and David died intestate. His son and daughter from a previous marriage sued for the insurance proceeds. They relied on a Washington state law that said in a situation like the Egelhoffs, designation of a spouse as the beneficiary of an insurance plan is revoked upon divorce. The question, does ERISA preempt such a state law? Yes, said the Supreme Court in a 7-2 decision. Justice Thomas's opinion for the majority said that courts must look to ERISA's objectives to determine what state laws would survive preemption. Here, he said, the state statute has an impermissible connection with ERISA insurance plans. It binds ERISA plan administrators to a particular choice of rules for determining beneficiary status. Moreover, it interferes with nationally uniform plan administration. If ERISA doesn't preempt this type of statute, some ERISA plan administrators might have to master the relevant laws of all 50 states. That, said the court, is precisely the burden that ERISA preemption was intended to avoid.
That concludes our look at the court's separation of powers and federalism cases. We'll take up habeas corpus in a moment. The court continued its efforts to clarify the statutory and case law governing state and federal inmates' use of habeas corpus, especially as affected by the occasionally imprecise language of the 1996 Anti-Terrorism and Effective Death Penalty Act, the AEDPA. Here to discuss five cases are Roy Levinson of Loyola Law School, Los Angeles, and Erwin Shemerinsky. And Laurie, we'll start with two cases that don't involve the AEDPA, at least directly. They involve how to attack state convictions used in federal sentencing guideline determinations, the criminal history score. Daniels versus the United States involved a federal conviction and whether or not habeas corpus could be used to attack state convictions. And there's some prior case law about other efforts to attack those convictions. What did the court say here?
Well, what the court said in Daniels is that a 2255 motion cannot be used to collaterally attack state convictions that were used to enhance the federal sentence under the Armed Career Criminal Act. In other words, while that defendant was in state custody and going through the state appellate process and the state habeas process, that was the time to attack those convictions. I think the court made this ruling for a good reason. It wants to promote the finality of judgments, and it says that's the best time to have all the facts present in front of the court to make those judgments. So it's too late by the time of the sentencing hearing. And this is really a continuation of what the court had held in the Custis case, that you cannot do these type of attacks at the time of the federal sentencing.
With one exception.
Yes, one big exception, which is if you have a conviction that was obtained without the right to counsel.
Now, for a state sentencing hearing, what's the law there? There was a decision the same day.
Yes, Lackawanna was decided the same day with the same result. The court said basically Daniels applies here too. You cannot use the collateral attack.
Those are both 5-4 decisions.
Right.
Thanks, Lori. Erwin, let's turn now to the language of the AEDPA. And we're talking here about a specific portion. It's codified at 2244D and has to do with a one-year limitation in the Act about filing habeas petitions. Let me just read the portion here because we're going to be referring to it several times. The time during which a properly filed application for state post-conviction or other collateral review is pending shall not be counted toward any period of limitation under this subsection. Now, the key phrase here, the subphrase, is a properly filed application for post-conviction or other collateral review. And an issue in the Santos versus Bennett case is how do you define properly filed application? What did the court say?
As you just pointed out, the Anti-Terrorism and Effective Death Penalty Act generally creates a one-year statute of limitations for filing habeas petitions. But it specifically says that that time period is told if there's filed in state court and if you properly filed a petition for post-conviction relief in the state system. States have argued that a petition is not properly filed unless there's no tolling if it's a situation where there were claims presented or there have been procedural defaults by the defendant in the state court. Justice Scalia, writing for a unanimous court, rejected that argument. Justice Scalia said that properly filed refers to the formal attributes, the procedures with regard to the filing, were the filing fees paid, was it properly docketed with the clerk. It doesn't refer to substantive matters. It doesn't include, for example, whether the petition presents claims that were procedurally defaulted.
So properly filed is procedural, not substantive.
That's exactly what this is.
Okay, thanks. Now let's go to the same language, Lori, but a different set of words within that provision. Let me read it again. The time during which a properly filed application for state post-conviction or other collateral review is pending should not be counted. And the question in Duncan v. Walker is what state modifies? Does it modify only post-conviction or does it modify collateral review? Now, let me just give the facts of this case. There's a chronology here. It'll put this in context. On April 10, 1996, Sherman Walker filed a federal habeas petition. 2 weeks later, April 24, 1996, the AEDPA becomes effective, and the one-year period kicks in, not the one in the statute, but the one the courts of appeals have all adapted for pre-AEDPA convictions. So a one-year limitation period starting April 24th. 3 months later, July 9, 1996, the district court dismissed the petition. He said he hadn't exhausted his state remedies. And then over a year later, on May 20, 1997, a year after the effective date of the act, Walker returned with a second petition. The district court said it was time barred. Court of Appeals said no, he gets credit for that 3 month period there because, said the Court of Appeals, state modifies other collateral review. The court didn't see it that way though.
Right, the Supreme Court did not. The Supreme Court, that the state modified both the collateral review as well. So it was only the state habeas corpus petitions that would toll the statute, not the federal one that was filed. Now, I think this raised some great concerns among the dissent and other members of the court, because what about the situation where you have a federal petition that's filed and it's not dismissed out until after the time is gone? That could create a great injustice. And we know statistically that most habeas corpus petitions are dismissed, I think something like over 60%. And of those, more than 50% of them are dismissed because of failure to exhaust. So this could pose a hardship unless the courts find some way around it.
Well, Justice Stevens suggested one. Could you comment on that?
Right. What Justice Stevens said is what the federal judges might do in a situation where they don't want the petitioner to lose all his rights is to basically stay the federal proceeding while the petitioner goes back and exhausts the state proceedings. And it was also noted that this decision could backfire because you could have more federal judges finding an exhaustion of state remedies where they might not have found it before.
Okay, thanks very much. Let's go now right to one more provision of the Act, a different provision, though. This is Tyler versus Kane. This has to do with retroactivity. Melvin Tyler was convicted in Louisiana of murder in 1975. He filed a variety of petitions, including a federal habeas petition. In 1990, in the case of Cage versus Louisiana, the court invalidated a jury charge that was substantially identical to the one that was used in his trial. So he came back with more petitions, including a second habeas petition, federal habeas petition, filed after the AEDPA. So in this case, he had to show, or he elected to show, let me again read the words of the statute. This is 2244 again. Have to show that his claim relied, here quoting, on a new rule of constitutional law made retroactive to cases on collateral review by the Supreme Court that was previously unavailable. The question is, how did the court interpret this phrase, made retroactive by the Supreme Court?
Well, the court interpreted very narrowly. What Justice Thomas said was that made retroactive meant that the Supreme Court made it retroactive
by itself,
and that you could not put together several of the court's opinions, even though in this case he had a pretty good argument. He said, look, it's just like Cage versus Louisiana. Then in Sullivan, the Supreme Court had said this type of jury instruction error was structural. It was not harmless. That would seem to meet the Teague standard, and therefore, in this situation, it should be seen as retroactive. The Supreme Court said no. We have to expressly say that it's retroactive. Now, Justice O'Connor does leave open the possibility that you could have multiple decisions by the court that make something retroactive, but it has to be very clear in the holding of the cases.
It really is almost a magic word situation. The Supreme Court has to say explicitly, and it has to be explicit, and it has to be in the holding, can't be indicta, that this is a decision that's made retroactive.
And even if it done it here, it wouldn't help Tyler.
It wouldn't help Tyler because it has to have been made retroactive before he files his petition, so he doesn't get any benefit if it is made retroactive later.
Okay, thanks, Mary. Thank you, Erwin. We'll return in a moment to conclude the program with some cases involving commercial litigation. Finally, copyright, punitive damages, and arbitration. Here to discuss these cases are Erwin Chemerinsky and Ernie Young. And Ernie, let's start with the last of the technology cases we made reference to in the start of the program. This involves the suit by Jonathan Tessini and other freelance writers against the New York Times and other fairly big publishers who paid them for their original contribution, but then provided those articles to online databases like LexisNexis without permission. And there was a lawsuit over that. Now, let's just get some of the words down here. In copyright parlance, the Times or a magazine that carried the article originally is a collective work. The freelance article was a contribution. And an issue here is this language from the Copyright Act as it was amended in 1976. It says the owner of the copyright in the collective work, and I'm quoting now, has the privilege of reproducing and distributing the contribution as part of that collective work, any revision of that collective work, and any later collective work in the same series. The question is, are these electronic databases revisions of the collective work? What did the court say, and what are going to be the implications of what it said?
Well, the court held that data services like LexisNexis and also CD-ROM compilations aren't revisions of the original newspapers and magazines because they don't reproduce the articles in their original context. A couple things to keep in mind and think about the implications of that. First of all, is that Section 201C applies only in the absence of a contract that allocates the rights. The industry practice now is mostly to have explicit contracts that allocate these rights, And so the most interesting cases in the end may be cases that interpret frequently used contract terms. For instance, a federal district court just held this month that a contract, a fairly standard contract, I think, which allocated the rights to a novel, did not give the publisher the right to republish the novel as an electronic book. We may see more of those cases, and those may be more important than the ultimate default rule. The second big question, though, is what to do with the works that are covered by this decision going forward. Right now, there's a lot of articles on electronic databases for which the owners of the databases don't own valid rights anymore. The question is what to do about the situation. And the Supreme Court here suggests that the district court has a lot of discretion about that on remand. In fact, one of the most important aspects of this case may be that the Supreme Court reiterated that just because there's been a finding of infringement doesn't mean that there has to be an injunction against continued publication. The district court will have discretion about that. And the district court may be able to create some sort of compulsory licensing scheme.
Erwin, let's go to the punitive damages case. This arose out of a complicated dispute over utility knife. But the key question here is that on a false advertising claim, the jury in a federal court case awarded Leatherman Tools $50,000 in compensatory damages, $4.5 million in punitive damages. And Cooper Industries complained to the judge that this was excessive under the Gore versus BMW standard, and the Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit said, well, you may have an argument, but the standard of review we're applying, it's into the discretion of the district court, so it upheld it. Now, what did the Supreme Court say?
Well, the Supreme Court reversed the Ninth Circuit here. In BMW versus Gore in 1996, the Supreme Court said that grossly excessive punitive damage awards violate due process. The Supreme Court here said whether an award of punitive damages is grossly excessive is a question of law. The appellate court should review it de novo. They thus rejected the Ninth Circuit's use of an abuse of discretion standard. I think that this decision creates a real burden on district courts to create a clear record so as to facilitate appellate review.
And let me ask you another question. In commentating on this decision, several have said that the district court has not only always created a record, also has something almost akin to a Daubert gatekeeping rule in terms of what goes to the jury and what goes back from the jury.
I think it's important to distinguish two different kinds of gatekeeping here. One is gatekeeping in terms of what goes to the jury. That's really what Daubert is about with regard to scientific evidence. And the latter is gatekeeping in the sense of reviewing the jury's award of punitive damages. This case involves the latter and emphasizes that district judges do have to carefully review punitive damage awards to make sure that they're not grossly excessive. District courts need to know that the appellate court is going to review them under the de novo standard.
Let me ask you one other thing. Let me read a footnote from Justice Stevens' opinion and ask you to comment on it. He says, nothing in our decision today suggests that the Seventh Amendment would permit a court in reviewing a punitive damage award to disregard jury findings of fact.
And that's an important point. The court is drawing the traditional distinction between appellate review of fact and appellate review of law. When it's a jury's finding of fact that's an issue, there can be no appellate review under the Seventh Amendment. But when it's a question of law, whether the award is, quote, grossly excessive, that is a question of law, and that's to be reviewed de novo.
Okay, thanks a lot. This term, three plenary decisions and one per curiam all upheld the use of commercial arbitration in employment and in other disputes. We've prepared a short review of these cases. Let's run that video now, and we'll return to discuss some of the implications of the most closely watched of the four cases involving mandatory arbitration of employment disputes.
Circuit City v. Adams involved the Federal Arbitration Act, or FAA, in employment contracts. In 1995, St. Clair Adams took a job with Circuit City. He signed an agreement to settle all employment disputes by binding arbitration. 2 years later, he sued Circuit City in state court. Circuit City then sued in federal court to compel enforcement of the arbitration clause. The Act says federal courts should enforce arbitration clauses involving commerce, but it excludes from coverage contracts that involve seamen, railroad employees, or any other classes of workers involved in foreign or interstate commerce. So, does the Act exclude only employment contracts of transportation workers or all employment contracts? In a 5-4 decision, the Supreme Court affirmed Circuit City's right to compel arbitration. It held the act excludes only transportation workers' contracts. Justice Kennedy based his decision on canons of statutory construction. Cases before the court next term may clarify the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission's authority to litigate on behalf of employees in spite of arbitration clauses. There will no doubt be additional litigation about the conduct of arbitration proceedings now that employers may insist on using contractual arbitration. The second case, Greentree Financial v. Randolph, also involved the FAA. Loretta Randolph financed a mobile home purchase through Greentree. The contract said disputes arising from it would be settled by arbitration. Randolph sued Greentree, alleging violation of the Truth in Lending Act. Greentree asked the district court to compel arbitration. It did so. Two questions. First, was the district court order compelling arbitration a final decision under Section 16 of the FAA and thus immediately appealable? Yes, said the court. Greentree argued that the order was not final because it occurred in an embedded proceeding involving both arbitration and other claims. Here, the Truth in Lending claim. Resolving a split among the circuits, the Chief Justice said that the FAA did not recognize the distinction between embedded and independent proceedings. Second, was the arbitration clause unenforceable because its potentially large hidden cost would force Randolph to forego her claims? No. There is a liberal federal policy favoring arbitration agreements. A party that wants to invalidate an agreement fearing prohibitive costs bears the burden of showing the likelihood of incurring such costs, which Randolph failed to do. The third case, Eastern Associated Coal, involved the court's longstanding recognition of a national policy favoring labor arbitration, except when an award is contrary to public policy. Eastern Coal fired truck driver James Smith for twice testing positive for marijuana use. An arbitrator ordered Eastern Coal to reinstate Smith. The arbitrator conceded he failed the tests and held that punishments less than dismissal were appropriate. The Supreme Court offered guidance on how to determine public policy here in respect to drug use in the workplace and how to determine if an arbitration award is contrary to that policy. Justice Breyer looked to the Omnibus Transportation Employee Testing Act and implementing regulations. They emphasize rehabilitation is critical to any testing program. They provide for reinstatement of workers who fail drug tests with limitations and restrictions, such as temporary suspension without pay and mandatory testing. Nowhere did the court find an explicit, well-defined public policy contrary to the arbitrator's decision. A fourth case involved former baseball star Steve Garvey and the Baseball Players Association. The court reinforced another well-established rule in labor arbitration jurisprudence. A court should not overturn an arbitrator's decision as long as the arbitrator is interpreting the contract, even if the court believes the arbitrator committed a serious error. The court emphasized that principle again in its 8-point per curiam opinion. Even serious error on the arbitrator's part, wrote the court, does not justify overturning his decision, whereas here he is construing a contract and acting within the scope of his authority.
Erwin, as the segment said, there's likely to be continued challenges to the use of arbitration, of mandatory arbitration now in employment disputes. In fact, there's legislation in the House to overturn the decision of the FAA. Why don't you tell us what you think challenges judges are going to see on several levels?
I think there are many different kinds of issues that are going to be litigated. As the segment we just saw indicated, there are going to be issues about the availability of discovery and the scope of discovery in arbitration proceedings under the Federal Arbitration Act. There's still going to be many cases raising issues about the relationship between the Federal Arbitration Act and state laws. Are state laws that preclude the enforcement of arbitration clause now preempted? I think the answer is yes after Circuit City versus Adams. Also, to what extent can there be challenges based on state unconscionability principles against contracts that have arbitration clauses? All of these and so many of the issues are left to be litigated after Circuit City versus Adams.
So there's more to come.
Yes.
Thanks very much, Erwin. And Thank you, Ernie. This concludes the Federal Judicial Center's fifth edition of Supreme Court The Term in Review. Many thanks to our faculty, not only for describing and commenting on the cases, but also for helping us structure and plan the program. Thanks to our Judicial Education Advisory Committees for guidance on case selection. Thanks also to Center Director Fern Smith and Judicial Education Director John Cook for guidance on the program. And thanks finally to you for joining us. Again,